saying you like carrying yourself around, but you're questioning me.
I'm gonna ask, is there any way?
Why are you asking me questions? I'm the boss. You come here to do the job.
You don't come here to tell me. Touche, but also,
you have a problem with authority. Bitch, don't kill my vibe.
Bitch, don't kill my vibe. Up in the clouds, me and my spouse. Rumors on the ground, getting too loud, we turn them shits down. Can't hear myself think.
I'm Diamond, you are tuned into the Kickback DMV with me and the Super.
Dive into your lower mind, see what I can find. Is it wet or dry? Only whispers will decide.
What's up? People like to say that we overshare on social media.
Okay.
And typically when I bring guests on, I kind of look through their social media, get a feel for things that I should talk about. But I'm going to say with you, you don't put a lot of personal things out there.
No.
What I will say is you are really into mental health,
yes.
Success, wealth, going after your goals and your dreams, which is cool.
Yeah.
But for me, people like me, I'm like, what am I going to talk about? So I do want to know a little bit about you. I'm just going to give you a couple of statements and you tell me if they are true about you or if they're not. And okay. Then you just tell me why. Cool. So the first one is, I do not get along with authority figures because I want to be the alpha.
It's false. The reason being is because for me, if I was to consider myself any category of male, I'm more of a sigma. I don't know if you heard of a sigma male.
Mm-hmm.
I can play the leadership role if I need to, but I also know when I can be observant and step back.
So let's take alpha out of it. Let's get rid of that word.
Okay.
Let me ask, does he got a problem with authority? Does he like to be told what to do? No.
No,
you just a homeboy. You gonna support.
I question authority. I question it. But I don't always like be like, oh, nah, it gotta be my way. No, I'm not that type of person.
So you're not gonna just play the background and just let it be. So if authority person is, you know, running things how they choose to run it, but you see an area where it could be fixed, you gonna step in and be like, maybe we should do it this way.
I will question it, yes.
If I'm the boss, if
you're the boss lady, listen, hey,
this is not a democracy.
No, it's a dictatorship?
At the job. All
right, so I'm like, hey, ma'am, listen.
Then it sounds like you have a problem with authority.
No, how does this?
I'm not saying you like carrying yourself around, but you're questioning me.
I'm going to ask, is there any way?
Why are you asking me questions? I'm the boss. You come here to do the job.
You don't come here to tell me. Touche, but also,
you have a problem with authority.
No.
You don't like the way I'm running things, so you come start asking questions. What do you need to ask me for?
But here's the thing. I'm going to give my respect to you regardless if you're my teacher. I'm a janitor. I clean. I've done a lot of different things, odd jobs in my life to where I know what it's like to want to be respected as a person. Mm-hmm. So I give people respect and due diligence until you show me otherwise, no matter what kind of figure you are.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay. You got a little witness back there. True or false for you, I have been told that I am self-centered and or arrogant. Have you ever in your life, whether it was a woman, it could have been an argument, it could have came out, a friend or whatever, has that ever been told to you?
Childhood.
Okay.
Being the oldest, you don't really want to have to share. It's like, dang, y'all stepped in my territory. Disrespectful.
Okay.
You know, but as I got older.
Define older. Because you're saying young. Like,
elementary school, like literally younger.
You grew out of it.
I grew out of it.
And when did this happen where you realized, dang, you know, it's not always about me?
High school. I was always big hearted. It's just, you know, when my siblings came around, I was like, man, dang, I always got shared. But then, you know, you understand and you grow to appreciate the things that you do for people without having to ask. Now, they're going to actually say the opposite. In my past relationships, they'll be like, yeah, you do a lot for people. And it's like, do you do for yourself sometimes?
So the self-centered or arrogance was solely amongst the siblings and not your interactions with other people?
Yes. It was more of a in the house type of situation.
Because you were being yourself at home? Were you masking it?
No.
Are you?
No, I realistically, I feel like we all have many layers. When I care for you, when I really am involved in your life, even if I don't know you as a stranger, I'm going to give you the most authentic version of myself.
I haven't dealt with you on day to day, but I feel that. You convinced me. And then this last one, when it comes to my love life, I have extremely high expectations.
I go into relationships thinking about if you have the potential to be a wife. I would say that's a pretty high expectation. I feel like if I've come across you and you've come across my path for some reason, mm-hmm. there's a learning lesson in everything.
So if the high expectation is wife, what is a wife? The characteristics, the attributes, because every woman out here will tell you, I'm a wife.
Yes, you know, we literally just had this conversation. So,
well, we need to know, so, hear from a man.
All right, what is a wife? These three things are one. Trust, loyalty, and support are one thing. Let's say I say, hey, I love you. I trust you. I'm going to be loyal to you. But you need my support, and I can't give you enough support. That's going to create some type of friction in the trust and the loyalty.
Well, let's pause there. The fact that trust, loyalty, and support are considered high expectations, what does that say about the women of today?
Ooh, that is... Why are you trying to hit me the guy?
Is that really a lot to ask?
Men are not difficult. We are not difficult. Now, through our traumas, mm-hmm. anybody can be difficult through traumas. Mm-hmm. But for the majority, and men, correct me if I'm wrong, because, hey, stand by your boy. All right? I'm the spokesperson. Stand by your boy. We're not really hard to please. We don't ask for too much on the sense of we need X, Y, and Z from you plus A, B, 9, 4 dash. We don't need no law code from Harvard. We don't need that.
Okay. So pretty much it sounds like, not that you're saying this, but the conclusion can be drawn that us women have an idea of what men want, and it probably exceeds the basics of what you're asking. So like, we're doing all this over here, and it's like, I really just want loyalty, trust, and support.
I'm telling you.
You over here trying to look like Rihanna and Beyonce and get your BBL, and it's like, that's not what I'm asking for.
I'm telling you. It can definitely be as simple as that.
The bar is low. Because even I've seen tweets where people be like, you know, I don't cheat, and that's a flex. I'm like, a monogamous relationship, that's a bare minimum. That's a requirement.
So because you don't cheat, that's a flex? No. Because you don't cheat, that should show your character. It should not have to be, that should be in your character. Right. That should be already instilled in you. For you to say it's a flex just lets me know that you think that you have the right to cheat, or it's like, why even go that route? If you feel like you have to cheat, leave. The essence of what it is, what's right and wrong, is taken out the picture.
Yeah.
I feel this way, so because I feel this way, it makes it right. No, it just makes it just, it's your objective or subjective opinion about something.
Mm-hmm.
It's not truth.
Yeah.
No, when people, well, I'm just living my truth. No, you're experiencing.
Yeah, no.
It's not living your truth. You're just
the truth is the truth. Don't matter who say it.
The truth is
the truth.
Exactly.
My truth means you lying.
It's like my truth is basically a hard, concrete opinion.
My experience. We need to change the verbiage. I like that. Yeah. We gonna stick a pin in that one. This next one is called Win It or Quit It. I'm just gonna give you some statements. Tell me if you with it. That means you agree. Quit it like now. And then we're gonna talk about it a little bit. Smoking weed is a waste of time. It is merely a pastime that gives a false sense of calming. Are you with that or you quit that?
I would say.
Are you a weed smoker?
I'm not a weed smoker. Okay. I don't smoke.
You have friends that smoke.
I have friends. I mean, I come from a pretty interesting dynamic of family. I got weed smokers in my family. I'm not against anybody who smokes. I think that, especially nowadays with the understanding of the medicinal uses.
Do you believe that this goes beyond recreational for the masses? Like everybody's like, oh my gosh.
For the masses? Now, for the masses, I will say, nah.
Okay.
But I personally know people who have, they've went through some traumatic experiences, and in their experiences, that is one thing that actually helps them with their productivity, so they won't have anxieties. I don't smoke. I don't knock the person who does. It's just not for me. I know people who are social drinkers, mm-hmm. and you know, they still do what they do,
mm-hmm.
and then I know functional alcoholics.
So you support substances that help your mood and make you feel a certain way, the same way you would support medicine that's over the counter?
Depending.
Is it cool to smoke and drink, and we should view it the same way as taking medicine.
I believe you should view it the same way as taking medicine. The reason why I'm saying that is because it's not drinking that's the problem.
Okay.
It's not smoking that's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is the overindulgence in things.
So you support smoke the weed if it's going, you know, decrease your anxiety. You know, drink if you want to relax. But the problems are still there. Those things that make you anxious, it didn't go away.
First of all, first and foremost, mm-hmm. I will say this. Get to the root of your problems first. If it is something that is a pastime for you,
mm-hmm.
by all means, that's your thing. You know what I'm saying? Some people...
So you don't think it's a waste of time?
For me, I don't smoke or drink. So, and if I did drink, it's very seldom. So for me, I don't do it. So I can't necessarily say what's a waste of time for one person. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, some people may think painting or, you know, doing certain things would be a waste of time for them.
So it sounds like in the world, there's no black and white. There's a bunch of gray areas.
You can't make gray without black and white.
Okay. Okay. The next one, classism is more of a problem than racism in America. You with that or you quit that?
Wow, that's actually a good one. I would say classism. And the reason why I would say classism is because those who are in a particular class, mm-hmm. they're up here. They regulate everything else. Our media is controlled by the upper class. The 1-3% controls everything. But classism is much more powerful because there's an aspect of control on a larger scale. They will over-televise the fear and fear-monger, those who are paying attention, just to build up this rage that 90% of people don't really deal with. 90% of people don't necessarily deal with racism at the core, right in front of their face. There are a few people that will deal with it and be like, yo, I can relate.
Right.
But not everybody's dealing with, not all white people don't like black people, not all Asians. It's literally media control. And that's where the money comes in. Mm-hmm. The separation of, I think that classism has more to do with the depths of racism,
mm-hmm.
but classism is global.
Great analysis, great breakdown, and I think that's good. This next one, Jesus is a mix of all races combined. The Bible is global history, not black history. You with that or you quit that? So that white Jesus that we see, that's a combination that's black, Indian, Hispanic, Asian, all in one.
No. A lot of what he's portrayed as is not necessarily, it's due to the history of the Council of Nicaea, which was the Roman Empire, was the reason for the change of the character of Jesus. But Jesus definitely was a black man. Even down to the description, like his, not on the dyed part, but you know, hide this right here. This was what his hair felt like.
You know, some people say we take that out of context.
I mean, they can say that, but historically, Caesar Bourgeois was a very wealthy aristocrat in Spain or in whatchacallit, got the same exact painting of his son. That, so there's evidence of that as well. Well, I definitely believe that he was a colored guy. He wasn't a mix of too many different things.
I respect that. All right, so this last one. Being black from the suburbs diminishes your credibility of being a black person. You ain't black enough if you ain't from the hood.
You know what's funny? The mentality is stupid.
Mm-hmm.
I don't agree with that. I can say it's respectable, is knowing that you don't have to adapt to everybody else's lifestyle. Because there, I know people that's from the hood that are incredible people. They're not drug dealers. Not everybody in that environment is drug dealers. Some of them want to be able to move their mom to a better place, and I know people that have done that. The stigma on what black is a problem.
Yes, I was going to ask you, what does it mean to be black?
Like,
somebody tell me I'm not black enough. What does that mean?
It's like, what do you associate? What are you associating black with? You know, and I think that people are only associating black or being black with the idea that this small segment of people that are entertainers, why can't there be black lawyers? Which there are, you know.
Right.
Why can't there be black doctors? Why can't there be black scientists, engineers? There is more than just basketball. Shoot, yeah. There are black soccer players, black baseball players. There are other sports to play.
There are.
Why not have black chess kids playing chess? Mm-hmm. You know, spelling bees. All of these different things in these. The world is much bigger than what we make it. Yeah, we see it on TV. It's easy to, okay, I feel like I've been to Italy. You haven't, though.
So what do you personally define as being black?
I feel like it's a soul thing. When I say it's a soul thing, it's like, there, of course, with the melanin as well. Like,
yeah.
I honestly wouldn't even want to necessarily use the term black. I would rather, you know... I think we're
not black. What are
we're indigenous to the world.
So what should we call ourselves?
We
change it every year.
We change it every year. It's like, if you notice, only here are we called black. Go to Africa, there's you're Cameroonian, you're right. Nigerian.
So what are you?
I'm a mutt. I'm indigenous and Caribbean.
So then we're mutts. Like
most of us are indigenous. We're not Native American, but we're indigenous to the Americas.
So help us figure out the name. Is it mutt?
No, it would be indigenous. That's okay. It. Just
so,
indigenous.
Hey, so next time, you know, when it's time to vote, I don't vote, but if you did, or job interview or whatever, you're going to opt in other.
I actually, that's why
you
I do.
Put other.
I put two or more races. And technically, hey, newsflash, we all are human. Well, so, not all of us. Some people, we ain't going to get there. You know what I'm saying? But for the most part,
mm-hmm.
we're human.
Mm-hmm.
So when they say race,
if
it's the human race. Technically, we can mark white on the thing because they got colors.
They got colors.
White.
It's whatever you.
So on the hey, look, y'all want to get a good job? Mark white on the thing. They're gonna. Oh my gosh! Hey, how are you doing?
So these white people don't not like us because we're black, because we're not black. It's just our features. So we're defined by our features.
We're defined on a spiritual level. Like,
do they define us that? Other people? Is that how we define ourselves?
I feel like we define ourselves in that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I also feel like people see it. Like, it's just like, you know, we all have our haters. We all have particular types of people
mm-hmm.
that may wish our downfall. The only reason why they could even wish for our downfall is... if they knew we could come up,
mm-hmm.
how you gonna pray on somebody's downfall if they're never gonna rise?
There you go.
So for me, I feel like when it comes down to white people, you know, and I don't have nothing against them. You know what I'm saying? Like I got good friends. You know what I'm saying?
Man, but, you sound like the white people that say I got a black friend.
No, I didn't
What's
say.
The difference?
See, I didn't say I have two. No, I didn't say I have two or three.
What's the difference?
Hey, I got 4.5. Good black friends. No, I give respect from every nationality, ethnic background.
You like character. You like.
I'm more based on character.
You would marry character, not indigenous.
I don't necessarily. I can't say that. For me, my preference
is what
is my sisters. Oh. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? My preference. Hey, look. And another thing. Look, I'm another thing. If you have a preference, don't let nobody try to force you to change your preference.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Because I feel like in our society, if somebody doesn't like something, they want you to not like it because they don't like it. When something is felt a particular way,
mm-hmm.
because you feel that way,
mm-hmm.
you want everybody to agree with you thinking that you're right.
So we shouldn't shame a black man for not looking to the sister first.
I feel like you shouldn't shame anybody for looking to anybody. Like,
no.
If you're,
if your friend over there said, "Nah, I'm not with the sisters," you're not gonna look at him sideways. It's like, hey, bro, that's your preference.
Hey, no, I'm gonna question them, and then you know, I'm supportive first. I'm gonna support whatever is right, whatever you feel is right for you. My preference. It's your sisters, you know what
so
I'm saying?
So you wouldn't say nothing to him? It's like, yeah, okay.
I'll look at him.
Yeah, I ain't with the sister. You know?
Hey, look, I'll look at him and be like, all right, bro, if this is what you want, look, I'll support it.
Do you really? You don't have a choice.
I have no choice. So, I'm loyal to a default. So, whatever it is like...
So, it's not just about character. It got to be about Is okay. If he didn't like the sisters, would you say that he hates himself? Is that considered self-hate? You don't want someone from your area, your skin tone,
no,
and that should be
that's why I had to elaborate on preference, because some people preference is not predicated on you hating something of yourself or not. There are people, I know people that just like what they like. That's what I mean by preference.
So when you get married, you have your children or whatever, you have your son, your daughter, it's you choose what you want.
I'm going to give them the tools and the principles of how to operate in life. And then from there, when it comes down to choice, understand that there is a character thing first, because at the end of the day, black men and black women.
Yeah, but okay, the black sisters, and we're going to decide amongst their character or everybody, and we're going to put all the good characters in a circle, and we're going to pick from the good characters. Or is it all the sisters, and then you pick out the good character? Your children, your legacy.
If you're speaking on mine.
This interview about you. We don't want the people. We want you.
So for me,
you,
I'm going to be like, look, you know, do your thing with what we have right here.
That right there?
You pointed there. You said the sisters and this.
Oh, okay.
So I'm saying right here, for me personally, mm-hmm. I would want to build and continue my legacy.
And what
that's just
that
me
be?
Personally. My legacy would
be... The good character legacy or the sister with the good character legacy?
It would be sister with good character legacy. Me personally, I come from a very scrappy background of fighters. And when I say that, I'm speaking on especially discovering my dad, more of my dad's side of the family. My great-grandmother and great-grandfather, they lived through the times where people would go to Vietnam and say, look, don't send me to Mississippi. So my great-grandfather and great-grandmother sacrificed their lives. They fought for the voters' rights in Shaw. All of these characteristics that it's in my blood. They led their people to where Hawkins versus the town of Shaw made it all the way to Congress. And it was passed so that way that the fellow residents can have proper plumbing, proper everything for their side of the town.
If y'all don't get nothing from this interview, at least find out where you come from in your family and your history. And I think that'll help shape what you choose to do
for sure.
Moving forward, so you can carry that on.
For sure.
So we're going to leave this off with something a little lighthearted. You know, I love trivia, so I'm going to give you two truths and a lie.
Okay.
And you're going to tell me, of course, which one you think is the lie. If you get it wrong, you got a little punishment. So let's just hope you get it right. I'm rooting for you. So the first one, Larry Hogan is part of the Democratic Party. Abortion is legal in all 50 states. Montel William is from Maryland. Which one is the lie?
Larry Hogan.
You're cheating and you're supposed to look over here.
No.
You think you're slick.
No.
You're gonna
Larry
look
Hogan is Republican. I know that.
Okay, cool.
Okay, cool. I'm not even from Maryland. I know that. I see.
No, okay.
Like, I knew that he was Republican.
Why?
Like,
why? No. What made him Republican?
Because, you know, when you
He's
watch...
He's from Maryland. Maryland is,
you know,
Democrats. Why
when you watch,
he be a Republican?
When you watch the news at the front part of it.
Okay, cool. All right, this next one. You're not legally allowed to curse while behind the wheel in the state of Maryland. Fortune telling is illegal in Baltimore. Or Brandon Smith is the mayor of Baltimore. Which one is the lie?
See, I'm not even from Maryland, so I don't even like...
Well, you came here.
So,
this is the
Brandon, Brandon Smith don't... That he sound like a football player. Is he from Baltimore? That's the dude from the 5th district of Baltimore or something. So he's the mayor, right? He really is a mayor. You're supposed to help me out too.
No.
Second one. We'll go with the second one.
The fortune telling. Fortune telling is illegal in Baltimore.
So it was the first one that was...
No, you are not allowed to curse behind the wheel while you're driving in the state of Maryland.
So Brandon Smith,
it's Brandon Scott. So you are going to be punished. Go ahead and close
I
your
was
eyes.
Right.
No.
I was right. I said Brandon
you're
first.
Just a second guess. Close your eyes tight. Close
you were them. Supposed to be on my side.
Close them. You ever see what that is? If not, I'm going to tell you what it is. All right, keep your eyes closed.
Brandon Smith.
Open your mouth. Tell me what it is and you'll redeem yourself. Your eyes is watering.
It's not hot though, it's just disgusting.
Come on, you got 5 seconds. You said it tastes like garlic. What is it? Four.
It's some type of garlic something.
It's garlic powder. Woo! Alright, this is next
Brandon Smith, I don't like.
Jay-Z's first album was titled Reasonable Doubt. Mm-hmm. Biggie Small's first rap name was MC Quest. Or French Montana was born in Algeria.
He wasn't born in Algeria, he's actually Moroccan, so.
All right, we got one more. Kanye West's album, College Dropout, was released in 2003. Mm-hmm. N.W.A. has a song titled Express Yourself.
Nope.
Or Eminem refused to perform Lose Yourself at the 2003 Grammys because he would have to perform a clean version.
N.W.A., no.
They did have a song called Express Yourself. College Dropout was 2004. Yeah.
I said,
man. Again. Not again, Martin.
And I was like, hold on, wait. 03, 04, 04,
03. My goodness.
Okay, okay.
Kanye is going to be disappointed in me.
You going to tell me what it is? Tell me what it is.
Yellow mustard.
Oh, good job. Good job. Okay. I'm proud of you. You are intelligent. You are smart. You know a lot. This was a great interview. We know inside your brain. High expectation, trust, loyalty, support.
Key.
That's the key.
Major.
He like black women.
I do.
And you want your children, your mans, and your friends, all them black women. You see, why are you not standing on it? What you scared of? You are definitely in the community. You are very helpful. You have a lot going on. So tell us about that.
I officially established my label, NDSV. That's actually my boy right there. He's co-founder, producer, fire. I love him. It's called No Dream, Straight Vision. It's an independent label. I call it more of a community / creative label. I don't want it to necessarily be limited to just music. We're focused more on photography, cinematography, music, vloggers, and just to connect the local community together. In August, we'll be setting up a back to school drive, performing, bringing more local artists to the forefront.
That's exciting. I look forward to it. So where can we follow you on social media on your journey?
Super_NDSV. 2 U's, 2 P's, and an A. I do more of my music on that page. So you'll catch me doing beats, rapping over his beats. We do all that. Motivational and business is None Like Dante.
Really good videos. I sat and watched.
Yes. Yeah. Though that is more geared to motivation. You get to see me in raw form.
Our last thing, you gotta leave us with some words of encouragement.
As you see, I don't know if y'all can see background, it's a little rainy. I will say, we have those days. We're gonna have them. The vision doesn't change just because it's a rainy day. It does not change. You don't stray away because, oh my gosh, it's difficult times. We're gonna have them. If the vision's given to you, take advantage of the vision no matter what. Nothing should stop you or deter you from getting to your destination. It may take a little while if you're starting independent on your business, you're trying to grow spiritually, whatever your goals are, do not let those rainy days take your eyes off of the finish line. Don't ever do that. Don't ever get stagnant because of everybody else in your ear or they providing you with rainy days and ups and downs. Stay focused on the prize. Stay focused on the end result.
I love it. I love it. That's a great way to end it off. I'm Diamond B. Frazier. This is D. Super, and you are tuning to Kickback DMV.
You know it.